You are now watching Zach Lesage, the best place to learn about competitive Pokemon TCG. Let's get it! Yo, what's poppin' YouTube? Welcome back to the channel. I'm so happy to have you here. Today we are going to be covering over my favorite video of every single week, and that is where I take the power rankings and I rank the top 10 decks. I showcase my deck list. By the way, the deck lists are in the pinned comment below. There's also reference videos for every single deck. They might not be the exact same deck list, but it will show you how to play these archetypes for your events or when you're playing casually on PTCGO. You're 100% welcome. That being said, check out the description while you're down there. I have links to all my sponsors, all the stuff going on, my socials, and I just launched my new merch shop. So if you want to help support the channel, feel free to pick up a t-shirt, a mug, a magnet, whatever you feel like. They're super awesome. I'm waiting on my order. That being said, give this video a like. It does help boost the YouTube algorithm to get this into the hands of more Pokemon fans. Subscribe to the channel. We recently just passed 4,000 subs. I'm so hyped about that. Thank you so much for all the support, everyone. I honestly mean that from the bottom of my heart. And I mean, we're on our way to 5K. I guess that's our next stop. So let's try to get there. I mean, Chilling Rains is coming up, so the hype's coming. So let's keep it rolling. That being said, let's jump into our number 10 spot, see exactly how we are kicking off this week. So starting off at number 10, we have a new entrant to the list, and that's gonna be Altaria Control. Now, some might call this deck Munchlax Control. In general, it's a control deck, and control decks have been on the rise to the point where they've been able to come 10th place on our top 10 decks. Now, that might not seem like a lot, but there's a very limited amount of players who are skilled enough to be playing control. A similar deck to this one was actually able to win Limitless, the series finale. So it's one of those things where I feel like players are becoming more skilled, understanding control. I think if your deck does not have answers to cheeky techs like Altaria in general, I think Altaria and Decidueye as a whole are seeing a lot more play, more type wall decks. So I think that decks like this are kind of trending upwards as we get prepared for the Players Cup 4 region qualifiers. Now, that being said, if you're looking to counter things, maybe in your Victini deck, you might want to have Volcanion, for example. Maybe you want to be packing that extra copy of Switch or Escape Rope or something like that. Now, it's not always going to work. I recommend testing at least a few games against some of the control decks. This is a deck that I plan on covering on my channel. I did link in the description below, or sorry, the comments below, that there's a Excadrill control deck. Very similar idea. Here you're just trying to trap your opponent with Galar Mine or block them with Altaria and mill their resources with Muk. At the end of the day, all these decks are just aiming to stop you to do from something if they all had some kind of unified front. So check out the vid when I get a chance to drop it. Check out some other control videos. Play against this deck, maybe test this deck and see what's going on, because I could see this deck staying within the top 10, lower half of top 10 by all means, but it looks like it's trending upwards right now, especially after the huge win at Limitless Series 32. Jumping into our number 9 spot, we have what I used to call Galaxy Mewtwo. I'm just going to call it Psychic Mewtwo. The reason for the name change is I realized that Galaxy doesn't necessarily describe what this deck would be, where this deck is more using the Psychic type Jirachi GX to accelerate Psychic based energy such as Aurora, Horror Psychic Energy, and Psychic Energy. So, name change alert, nothing else going on, it's very similar deck. Now, this deck hasn't really seen too much innovation in the past couple weeks. It's getting some top placements by the players who are normally playing it. They like to call this deck Jit 2. I mean, they're really the ones who kind of brought this deck back to this current format or created this archetype in the Battle Styles format. So, I mean, I think they're going to be more skilled than most other players. However, this deck does seem to be, like, falling a little bit. I think it's a lower half top 10 deck. And I think that means it's always going to be in bay. So it's not necessarily something that you should super worry about. It exists, but it's nothing like ridiculous where you, like Pikarom, for example. Like, you wouldn't play Lapras because it loses to Pikarom for the most part. Just because Pikarom's a top play deck. Same way that I wouldn't be playing ETERNATUS right now because it loses to Rapid Strike Urshifu. I think this deck's just going to kind of stay down here for a little bit. And it could eventually fizzle out of our top 10. However, I think it's going to be more or less once Chilling Brains pops up, we'll have to see exactly what's going on there. So, I think that this deck It's fine if you like playing this deck. Otherwise, I'd probably just like chill out and pick something else. So here we got a pretty basic deck list for ETERNATUS coming in at number 8. And I mean, this deck dropped from number 4 to number 8. Mainly because it does not have a lot of great matchups right now. Sure, it falls into the realm of it's a neutral deck. And I mean, if you're hitting things like Grass, Mewtwo, ADP, it sounds okay. But Rapid Strike Urshifu is kind of on the rise. Huge. Like, huge, huge. So it's one of those things where this deck always goes toe-to-toe with Pikarom, might lose to Pikarom. This deck goes toe-to-toe to Tempozard, might lose to Tempozard, could still lose to ADP. It comes to a point of, why are you playing ETERNATUS VMAX? At one point, I thought this deck was the best deck in format, but once Rapid Strike Urshifu came out and became such a tier 1 deck, it's one of those things where ETERN naturally has to go down. Now, good thing for this is any deck that counters ETERN, any deck that counters Rapid Strike Urshifu, I should say, ETERN usually does a good job at countering. So decks like Mad Party that have fallen out of the top 10 for a couple weeks now, decks like Psychic Mewtwo that typically do well against Galaxy or against Rapid Strike, this deck does well against. So if Rapid Strike Urshifu is at the top of the metagame, this deck can creep up. Now I'd say that this deck's probably 5th place and below, maybe 4th place and below. I don't necessarily know if it's going to make our top 3 for the foreseeable future. And with Chilling Rains coming out with all of those decks, all those cards that counter the ETERNATUS VMAX, I don't necessarily think that this deck's going to get a chance to fly for a little bit. So probably appropriately placed at this moment. Now you can see I changed the list up a little bit, adding Crushing Hammers, giving yourself a better chance against some matchups, especially if you do run into a random mirror or anything like that. Cutting Scoop Up Net because you could never knock out two Victinis with a Zigzagoon Net combo. So overall, I think this list looks really good if you're playing the deck. Cut Phoebe because LUCMETAL is a little bit low as well. But if you like ETERN, ETERN's still fine. I just wouldn't really recommend playing this deck at this moment. Jumping into our number 7 spot, we got LUCMETAL. This is a deck that I used to hold near and dear to my heart. I hated this deck, love this deck, and now I'm back to kind of hating this deck. And I would not touch this deck with a 10-foot pole right now. Reason being is it's seeing a little bit more success than it was last week because Rapid Strike Urshifu is on the rise. Decks have to attach to another deck. There's always a correlation to why a deck's being played. You don't play a deck for any reason. And if you are the type of player that plays a deck for no reason, think about the reasons why you want to play a deck. It's probably going to improve your win con and your win rates. So this deck obviously has a great Rapid Strike Urshifu matchup. That's why this deck's seeing a little bit more success this week comparatively to last week. But this deck gets absolute toasted by Victini and absolute toasted by Tempozard. Holds a 50-50 against Pika. Holds a tough matchup against Grass Mewtwo. I mean, there's not a lot of great matchups that this deck is just like beating. So when I was playing this deck for the Players' Cup qualifiers, it's one of those things where, yeah, I was able to farm Dragapult players who were playing Dragapult for some reason and Dragafu and all these kinds of decks. LUCMETAL's great at beating players that don't know how to beat LUCMETAL. And I mean, I think I found a time that worked really well for me to play LUCMETAL. I think I found particular pockets in the metagame that I was able to use LUCMETAL to gain a lot of tournament rep. But it's one of those things where now that the metagame is settling down a little bit, there's not as much ETERN, and Rapid Strike still has a lot of counters that this deck can lose to. I think that this deck is like severely only a metagame call. If you think it's a good metagame to play LUCMETAL, go for it. And I only think there's a few players who are qualified to make that call. Maybe the Josh Sutherlands, the Hayden Frews, the Epos of the world, the Jake Gearhearts. Otherwise, I think that you're just going to run into fire and get burned. And that's how it's going to go. You're either winning the event or you're going like 1-2 drop. Usually, LUCMETAL doesn't fall in between. So going forward, I think fire is just like continuously seeing success. Nothing really douses it because the rest of the metagame counters water out of the formats. This deck just isn't really cutting it right now. Jumping into number 6, we got ADP Zacian. Now, ADP Zacian used to rule the top of the metagame, but I think players stopped playing this vanilla deck and started playing other decks, such as Victini. More players that are just kind of like casually playing the game or middle tier competitive are going to stick to decks that are relatively easy to play. Since Victini Rapidash got introduced into our metagame, Victini is very much Attach and Energy Evolve Knockout V Pokemon. The same way that ADP can stumble into wins, Victini can. Victini typically has a better matchup spread than ADP. However, ADP is still a very neutral deck, where not a lot of decks have a great answer against it. Although they might have a decent matchup, they might not have all the answers. So they could stumble to putting a Chaotic Swell in play and dropping a Mawile GX, or just missing a turn and ADP does ADP things and goes Altered Creation GX. I think this deck's like relatively well positioned because it has 50-50-ish matchups against the top five. You're probably playing this deck in a relatively unknown metagame is what I'd say. I think ADP is like a very safe choice, especially if you're trying to uphold a win rate or anything like that. I mean, I don't necessarily think this deck is going to spike in events. Its top placement in the past week was second at the Limitless event that Control won. It isn't really beating too much, and it's still susceptible to Control in a lot of ways. So, I mean, nothing really changing with this list beyond adding in a Chaotic Swell just for the amount of fire that's seeing play. Surprise, surprise if we haven't seen fire by now. Fire's probably up there. But there's nothing wrong with ADP at the same time. So if you're one of those filthy ADP players, continue to play the filthy busted deck. So jumping into number 5 at our halfway mark, we have Grass Mewtwo. So Mewtwo deck's doing pretty well again, and again, they're probably attached to the fact that Rapid Strike Urshifu is weak to Psychic. So Psychic type Pokemon beat Pokemon weak to Psychic more often than not. Now, this deck, I believe I predicted that it was going to be within the top 5. I mean, falling from number 3 to number 5, it might sound like a lot to some. It's 2 spots, and I mean, it's a minor change, if anything. This deck, more or less, like, it's okay against Urshifu. It somehow continuously does okay against Fire-type decks. I think this is, again, it's just quickly becoming a neutral deck, where you could be Grass-type, or you could be Psychic-type, or you could be powering yourself up with Rillaboom to get around Control. This deck has general answers against the general metagame. I don't think this deck's necessarily going to spike up as number 1. I don't think this deck's going to spike up as number 2. But I think it's going to be within the 3, 4, 5, 6 range as long as people continuously play this deck. Now, this deck is the victim to... It's not super fun to play, in my opinion. I feel like you're just doing the same power up, you use super growth to get a Rillaboom out, and then you attack, and then you attack, and then you attack. You heal a little bit in between. It might not be everyone's cup of tea, so it's one of those things where a deck like this might be boring for some to play, which means there might not be a lot of players playing it. Some of these cards are hard to acquire in general, so I would just keep that in mind while you're playing this deck. Again, I think it's probably just going to stay within like that 3, 4, 5, 6 range. Nothing crazy. Hasn't really affected the metagame too much, if you ask me. Jumping into our number 4 spot, and falling from number 2 is Tempozard. Now, Tempozard has seen a lot of success. I mean, again, it's quickly becoming a very good welder type deck. It's always been a good welder type deck, but in a lot of ways, this deck is very rewarding. So Welder in general, the only two Welder decks that made this list are Victini and Tempozard. We haven't seen Victini yet, so we'll still see where it falls. But the big thing is, Welder decks are kind of a high roll deck in a way. They're not bad, they're somewhat consistent because of Jirachi. And the whole thing is, if you go Welder, 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 you can kind of almost drown your opponent out from playing the game. It's recently what happened to me at the E&D's Invitational. I lost to a Victini player twice. Nothing against my opponent at all. When you hit the welders, you hit the welders. And if you hit the welders, you can kind of just go Reshazard attack, Blacephalon attack, Galarian Rapidash attack. Same thing with Victini. You can go Victini attack, Heatran GX attack. As long as you're attacking every single turn, you're probably doing more damage per turn than your opponent. You're probably drawing more prize cards per turn than your opponent. These are factors that allow you to win games. It's a big deal. So it's one of those things where if Welder's hitting Welder's, Welder's usually winning the game, and it's very hard to stop. I mean, I could see this deck just staying. I think it's within the top 5, probably within the top 4. I think it's very appropriately placed. Surprisingly, like, Victini did place above this deck, but I think it's due to the ease of play where this deck is more complex, this deck is a little bit more fragile, this deck's a little bit better in best of three. I think when it comes to like things like the Players Cup, Victini and Tempozard are going to switch spots. So overall, super solid deck, nothing crazy going on here. I like the one Cram, one Rapidash splits, but if you are missing any cards from this deck, I've seen people cut a Reshazard for a Heatran, I've seen people cut Rapidash for a double V. I mean, you can add techs as long as you could power them up with Welder. Jumping into our third spot, we got Pikarom. Now, this deck is falling from number one. Again, it's just a two-spot drop, and the metagame is going to change. When you're at the number one, decks want to throw you off the top, and you can't go to, like, anything higher than number one beyond just staying at number one. So there's a good chance if you're, like, wobbly at number one and you're just not cemented and there are counters, people are going to bring out those counters. So again, we haven't seen Rapid Strike Urshifu on this list yet. And I mean, Rapid Strike Urshifu is a difficult matchup for Pikarom. Not impossible to win, but if I'm playing it in a tournament, I'd rather not see it. Now, this is the deck that I brought to the E&D's Invitational. I placed fifth. My teammate and testing partner, Gabriel Smart, won the Jai Cup with this. So it's one of those things where I think Pikarom is very good, especially when the hands of a player who knows what's playing it. The Mike Fouchés of the world, the Azul GGs of the world, they all know what they're doing with Pikarom very well. Other players like Danny Altavilla definitely know what they're doing with Pikarom. So top players are really driving the results of this deck to the top. They're getting those tournament wins because Pikarom can go through anything. I've been able to beat Dragapult Urshifu decks. I've been able to beat Rapid Strike Urshifu. Control decks, Lucmetals, ADPs, throw it at me, I got a chance. Most of the times I'm losing with this deck is when I have a poor hand or when my opponent's absolutely hitting the stones. So it's one of those things where Pikarom, it's pretty much well built. We took my Players Cup 2 winning list, and every list is adapted to that. I think every list is playing the double Mewtwo. Every list is playing the Crushing Hammers, the Big Charms now, the Chaotic Swells. Like, the list is very well defined, and I mean, you might see lists play minus one Big Charm, plus one Stealthy Hood, plus one Chaotic Swell, plus one Air Balloon. Like, there's very limited things that you could do to Pikarom because almost every single stone has been unturned. I think this deck is definitely just going to be within a top 5 deck, depending on how well Rapid Strike, Urshifu, and other counters potentially keep on doing. Because even, like, unlisted at, like, number 15 or something like that is, like, colossal decks. So fighting type decks with Pikarom being up top, players are looking for all ways to try to counter this deck. Jumping in at our number 2 spot, we got Victini VMAX. Now, this is a deck that was previously number 5, shot all the way up to number 2, and I think it has to be attributed that this deck, I found in my testing, I've had a pretty good matchup against Rapid Strike Urshifu VMAX. This deck single-handedly can just beat anything by just going Victini first or second, attaching an energy, and then evolving into a Victini VMAX, and being like, LOL Max Victory. I think that this is probably a neutral fire deck, if I could ever call it anything. Meaning, it doesn't really have a bunch of poor matchups or super great matchups, beyond things like Lucmetal, of course. Because some neutral decks have some good matchups, don't get me wrong. But this deck is very simple to play by using attaching an energy to a Pokemon like Victini V and evolving and using Max Victory. Now, there's layers of depth to when it comes to this deck. Slightly easier to play than Tempozard, if you ever had to ask me. And probably worse matchup spread than Tempozard, and that's just due to its ease of play. I added a couple Volcanians because I have seen a lot of Decidueye, Altaria control decks floating around this past week. I also have Tool Jammer into the deck because Big Charms in a lot of decks can just kind of screw up the math with Galarian Rapidash V. I think this deck is pretty well refined. Now, I would like to cut the Volcanians out of the deck. Of course, there's some synergy with Flare Starter being a fire deck, going second, all of that good stuff. But mainly, it's a good tech against Altaria, Decidueye, and some control decks. So, overall, I think that this deck's probably going to stay within the top 5. But if anything, number 2 seems a little bit high for it, if you had to ask me. So probably just a very isolated week with results. Jumping in at our number 1 spot, and jumping all the way from number 7 last week, we got Rapid Strike Urshifu. So if you've been watching my videos for a minute, you realize that I have not featured the Chinchino version of this build. up until now. And the reason why is it just hasn't necessarily seen the success that other versions have, in my opinion. I kind of looked at it where Azul won the Players' Cup, Torrid came top four, and it was one of those things where Azul was playing a standard Rapid Strike Urshifu build, and you had Torrid playing this Chinchino New Age version of build. Now, you might be like, would Torrid be playing Chinchino with Rapid Strike because it's similar to decks that he's done well at Internationals? He's even made that joke himself. Now, over time, most of the community agreed. We all stuck to the Players' Cup 3 champion-winning list. And in the past couple weeks, the Chinchino build has started to pop up more and more and more, to the point where this is the more successful build this past week, based off of the numbers and data that I've collected from the Play Limitless website. Now, the reason why? Probably because Control's seeing a little bit more success, if you had to ask me. Or maybe players think that this version's more consistent. Or you got a player that did well at the beginning of the week with this, the community saw that, and then they continued to play it. It's really hard to predict why they played one version of the list instead of another version of the list. But at the end of the day, we have this version of the deck that has seen more success overall. So that's why I'm covering it on the channel. I do plan on covering this in a video this week, so stay tuned for that. I'm going to fully explore this deck, so if you haven't seen this, since the Players Cup 3, where Torrid made top 4, I'm going to cover it on the channel and do a deep dive on this deck. So I'll keep you tuned on what's going there, so check out the channel when you can, check out the socials, and we'll see where this deck's at. I think that this deck, it's the reason why PIKAROM went down from number 1, it's why E-turn's all the way at the bottom. This deck can control a lot of the metagame, so keep that in mind. We might see other counters come out to try to beat this deck. The Mad Parties, the Galaxy Mewtwo, Psychic Mewtwo decks, the Mewtwo Urshifu decks, LUCMETALs. So the metagame is probably going to change a little bit, but Rapid Strike Urshifu has kind of vibed out at the top before for a few weeks. I think it has a chance to do it again. So if anything, I mean, you can't necessarily go up, but there is a chance it's going to stay within the top 5, if you have to ask me. Likely the top 3. And that's what we got going on for this week, peeps. Hopefully you enjoyed watching this video. Maybe the power rankings are exactly as you thought it would be. Maybe you had the conversation with your friends on Discord and you're like, yo, these are my top 10 decks. This is exactly what's going to happen. Maybe you got some beef with me. I know some of y'all like commenting that you're like, yo, why did this deck make it? Zach, you suck, whatever. Let me know in the comments below. Don't say Zach, you suck. I mean, I try to just literally do this out of the goodness of my heart. Yeah, sure, YouTube's paying me a little bit. That's going to codes and creating merch shops and stuff like that. So, fun times. That being said, I got a lot of editing. If you haven't given this video a like, give it a like. Subscribe to the channel if you're new. And just double check to see if you haven't subscribed. A lot of my close friends have not subscribed to this day. And it's one of those things where they're like, I forgot I didn't subscribe. Subscribe. And check out the description again for any of the sponsors. I mean, like I said, I just created that merch shop. Every little bit helps me out as a content creator. And the pinned lists are in the comments below. In the pinned comments. Yeah, all top 10. Stay tuned for a lot of great stuff on the channel this week. Thank you so much for watching, everyone. Peace out. I want to give a huge shout out to everyone who's become a channel member. It's one of those things where I appreciate every single person who watches my videos, and I mean, that's really where it counts, but for the channel members, they've gone out of their way to financially support me, and I truly appreciate that gesture. It's one of those things when I started channel memberships up on my channel, and I just didn't know if anyone was ever going to do it, so I truly appreciate everyone taking the plunge, taking a leap of trust, and investing in me as a content creator. Truly makes a difference for me each and every month. If you haven't already thought about becoming a channel member, you might want to contribute to the channel, and I do put everything back into the channel to make it the best possible place to watch for Pokemon TCG content. Again, I truly appreciate everyone. Thank you so much. Cheers. I truly appreciate you taking the time out of your day to watch this video. It means the world to me. And my goal with this channel is to spread my love of the game and knowledge with our entire Pokemon TCG community. If you haven't already, help signal boost this video to other Pokemon TCG fans by liking it, sharing it with your friends, and subscribing to the channel. Hopefully we reach our goals really soon. Check out this recommended video, and have yourself a great day. Thanks.